So our first official operational application of dual polarization data is with a signature that we call the ZDR column. And so it's a way to track updraft location and evolution with more confidence. We have a nice unique signature that exists, and it can tell us where a thunderstorm updraft is, how it's evolving, is it strengthening, is it weakening. So moving ahead, differential reflectivity. We just covered this, but to go through it one more time, what are we talking about with reflectivity or differential reflectivity? So what are the shape of the precipitation particles? Again, are they wider than they are tall? Are they taller than they are wide? So when we're dealing with raindrops, for instance, again, we have them wider than they are tall if we're dealing with larger raindrops. And so that gives us higher differential reflectivity. The same with melting hail or those ice crystals. But for this presentation, we want to focus on these larger raindrops. When we start to deal with smaller raindrops, again, we have horizontal and vertical axes that are pretty similar to each other. So we get similar power returned in both the horizontal and the vertical, and that drives differential reflectivity down closer to 0 to 1 dB. So what are we talking about with the ZDR column? We'll look at once again at a thunderstorm, a nice cumulonimbus cloud with an anvil off in the distance. Again, we're doing pretty well storm chasing, it appears. We keep finding these storms really nicely. So we have our updraft and our downdraft regions. And we can imagine here an isotherm of about 0 degrees Celsius, 30 degrees Fahrenheit. So this is our freezing level or melting level, depending on where you're looking at it, whether in the updraft or the downdraft. So within our updraft, we have this distribution of precipitation particles. You have some larger drops that are present, some of them being lofted above our freezing level. And so they don't have to freeze instantly when that occurs. It's not like once you get above the freezing level, once you get above 32 degrees Fahrenheit, everything freezes instantly. You can have drops in a liquid state still, and it's called supercooled liquid drops. You have maybe some smaller drops as well, and perhaps some growing hailstones, or maybe some small grapple, things like that, in your updraft. In your downdraft area now, you have more frozen particles. You have rain, too, that's falling in there. We don't have it shown here. Maybe some big hailstones falling right on the edge of the updraft. And way up above, you have maybe some crystals, some snow crystals that are growing aloft. So there's our radar one more time. We build it quite quickly, and there we're sending out our radar beam. So how are we looking at the storm? We can imagine this beam as a cross-section. This is just a basic example of reflectivity. So we're used to seeing our greens, our darker greens, our yellows. As we get to heavier precipitation, we're dealing with some of our reds that we're used to, maybe 50, 60 plus dBz. And so we can imagine as it's cutting through all of this precipitation, all this heavy precipitation, we see an increase in our reflectivity. Now, how does it look in differential reflectivity, ZDR? Because we want to see this thing called the ZDR column. So here we can imagine ZDR. And you'll notice this little spike in values kind of on the southern flank of where we had that higher reflectivity, values that are maybe 3, 4 dB plus. So where that is located is right here in our column area, where we're seeing our beam go through an area of a few supercooled liquid drops, some of these bigger drops that exist, maybe a few growing hailstones that have a coating of water on them. But the main theme here is that we're seeing our beam go through an area where a lot of the precipitation particles, again, some of those bigger drops, maybe growing hailstones, have much more horizontal component to them than they have a vertical component to them. And so that returns higher ZDR, if you recall, back to the radar. And so we get this vertical area that's known as the ZDR column, whereas if we look at different radar tilts as we tilt up progressively with our radar, we get this area, a nice continuous area of high ZDR, where we're scanning these large drops, these growing hailstones that are being lofted by our thunderstorm updraft. So this is how the ZDR column tells us where our updraft is located. So let's look at an example of how we want to spot a ZDR column and what does it look like in real radar data. That's what we're interested in the most here. So we'll move to our example from Raleigh, North Carolina. The time on this is 2140Z. We'll move forward a little bit in time, as you'll see over the next few examples. And the radar tilt will always be indicated in these. And in this case, it's 2.4 degrees. Typically, when we think of base reflectivity, base data, we're looking at 0.5 degrees. Of course, you know, not everything's happening right near the surface. We want to look up as well. And so here we're looking at 2.4 degrees. Remember, too, we want to see where all those raindrops, those larger particles, are being lofted above the freezing level, because that's where we can really start to pick out that ZDR column, where we see those higher values of ZDR sticking out from those lower values of ZDR. And so our focus here is to what looks like a relatively innocuous cell, not much reflectivity to it. And ZDR is all close to zero. We don't see anything that looks like a ZDR column here. And the reason why ZDR is lower is because we're dealing with a lot of frozen precipitation particles, things like snow aggregates, other crystals that generally are giving us relative contributions or contributions in the horizontal and the vertical that are equal to each other, which again gives us ZDR closer to zero. But we look at the freezing level, though, or above the freezing level when we're trying to find ZDR columns, because we want to see where all that liquid water is being basically injected above the freezing level by an updraft, because then we can spot that signature of high ZDR, and if we see it blossoming, growing in size or higher ZDR values, that's telling us we have a stronger updraft that's lofting more and more liquid precipitation particles above the freezing level, and that tells us that we're seeing a storm that's about to strengthen or that is strengthening. So as we go forward in time with this cell, this individual cell, you'll notice something. And it's pretty subtle, but we want to use subtle cases a lot. We're not always dealing with monster supercells that are raking across the plains. We also want to know how to use this with your regular old everyday thunderstorm. So here's our cell still located down here. And you'll notice right here this higher value of ZDR, where we're starting to deal with values more in the range of 3, 4 plus dB. That's where you have those liquid drops, those wider than they are tall liquid drops being lofted above the freezing level. And so right there, if we tilted our radar up and down, we're not doing it here, but if you were to do that, you would see this continuous area of ZDR. That's the ZDR column. So now we're going to do an actual cross-section, and you'll see a better idea of what we're talking about with this cross-section. So here's reflectivity. Our freezing level is located right about here, and we'll overlay a line to show it even better in just a second. But we're not dealing with some monster of a thunderstorm that's rising well above our freezing level to very high heights, maybe only 20,000 feet here. So now we go to differential reflectivity, and we'll overlay our freezing level, which was about at 10,000 feet for this day, and see this very high area of ZDR that's going well above the freezing level. That's the ZDR column. That's where our updraft is taking those drops and lofting them well above the freezing level, and they don't even have a chance to freeze yet while they're being lofted. So they stand out in terms of differential reflectivity relative to other areas of the storm. That's the feature that we want to track, and that tells us something about our updraft. We have a strengthening updraft that's lofting all this liquid water above the freezing level. So now we're going to go back to our previous image just to reorient ourselves, and now we'll go forward in time a few more minutes, and you'll notice our storm has strengthened. Worked so nicely. If you can spot these ZDR column signatures, you can identify which cell maybe is going to develop more than another. If you see one with high ZDR to very high heights, and you see another cell that perhaps has really ZDR close to zero above the freezing level, you want to follow more closely that storm that has that sort of injection of high ZDR values above the freezing level. So we notice here our cell has developed nicely. But as we move forward in time, there's something interesting that we're going to see here. And we'll light it up with the arrow. Whoa, check this out. I spotted just this monstrous ZDR column now. This is looking, I got to really pay attention to this storm here on this back edge. It's kind of in an area where we might expect the updraft, sort of positioning itself on the southwest flank. But we're going to look at something, correlation coefficient. Now we'll start to bring this into the game. Correlation coefficient, again, remember, tells us maybe if something's meteorological, if it's not meteorological. Look at how low these values in correlation coefficient are. We're dealing with values 0.5, 0.4, 0.3. Those are non-meteorological returns there. That's not actually small raindrops that we're looking at. Right, what we're dealing with here, and we're going to talk about that in a different presentation, is a three-body scatter spike from hail that's causing these high values of ZDR. So I give you the big stop sign right here and say, whoa, CC is like 0.6, perhaps even lower. That's non-meteorological. We don't want to use these data where they're overlapping that low CC to say that's a ZDR column. Now, perhaps this is right here if we were to take a look at it, but not this right here. That's where we use correlation coefficient to tell us how much we can trust the data. So we're going to use a squall line case. The squall line blows through right there. Those are my fancy animation skills for you guys, by the way. Here's the squall line case from Lake Charles. We're dealing with an early morning case, 1041Z. And we're going to draw another cross-section through it and take a look at this cell or this line of storms here. So there's our freezing level that we've overlaid again. Now we'll look at ZDR. We don't really see any nice tall tower of ZDR reaching above the freezing level, so we don't really have as nice a ZDR column signature. We look at our next scan, though, and what we see is much higher column of ZDR reaching above the freezing level. And so that's our ZDR column signature. It tells us something about the updraft there. It's strengthened. We need to watch this area more closely. We should expect maybe some increase in reflectivity. We go forward in time, continue to see that area of ZDR, that column reaching well above the freezing level. And if you notice, as we switch back to reflectivity, now we see this nice overhang in reflectivity. We can see how it's really developed and lofted more precipitation, more hail, more rain, well above the freezing level. And we've just seen more stuff develop from a stronger updraft. We continue to go forward in time, and we see a nice increase in reflectivity now as it's falling down to the surface as we start to see that collapse of heavy precipitation particles down to the surface. We were able to use the ZDR column to spot where an updraft was and if it was strengthening, and that gave us an idea of maybe how we could expect reflectivity to evolve going forward. So ZDR columns, what can we expect with them? How do we want to use them? We want to use that signature to spot updrafts, and we can then anticipate convective trends. You got to look up top because we want to look above the freezing level where we want to see those raindrops stand up from everything that's frozen. We want to see where the updraft is injecting all this super cool liquid water basically above the freezing level. Often that's above 10,000 feet. And then an intensifying ZDR column can predict reflectivity, increasing reflectivity over the next 10 to 20 minutes, sometimes dealing with stronger supercells, maybe a longer time range in the prediction, dealing with more individual cells, something on the range more of about 5 to 10 minutes in terms of the predictive capabilities. And with that, we end the presentation on ZDR columns.